It was a project that we have been developing so far as an initiative for the global epidemic and health for discovering of mostly human data, also normally human data, and a scientist or clinician could find whether a variant is or not present in a pool of aggregated genomics data without revealing the actual sequencing data that has some privacy issues. Then growing from a number of driver that have adopted this as a solution for variance data sharing, this tool has been increasing as better queries, more complex queries, and can be sequencing data after the pandemic was. We decided to jump in this scenario and expanded the architecture of Beacon B2 to adapt it variants from viruses, and in this way we add facilitating the discovery of variants data and their associated metadata for epidemiologists, clinicians, for themselves to store this amount of data or analyzing by themselves, and hopefully help the community in this sense. For this, we decided to we designed a pipeline to get public data and metadata from public sources, and then we leveraged the Galaxy pipeline and our own pipeline to develop pipelines as specific pipelines for the different sequencing data available, including shortlist for Illumina or also nanopore data, and also from assemblies. And we got all this data and make it public in friendly user interface. And here I can present you our user interface. When you can see on the left, the query types that that a user will be allowed to do on all this data coming either for raw from raw sequencing data or consensus data. Exemplifying better this, specifically user can either look for one single nucleotide variant or even deletions and insertions, or in a specific amino acid query that, for example, they have read in literature or they have found functionally relevant in their labs. And also they can whether to query whether or not variants or missense variants or any relevant variants have been appearing in regions or even in some functionally regions, like for example, PDC binding domain, for example. And we also have I was saying that also, apart from the query types, we have developed these filters with some of the metadata that is available that we think that might be useful for the virologists, including the variant type, the effect of the variants, functional class, frequency in population, models, etc. And this would be how the results would look like, for example, for a typical query based on genomic coordinates, like actual variant or region or amino acid query. When then you get the results of all variants that are found in that regions with associated metadata, including the frequency per data set that we included in our beacon. And this would be also the typical result, somehow different from motifs, when you can actually spot the actual position in the k-mers where the mutations are affecting. And this actually allows for lose matching. So if you would be able to find out if some motifs are appearing because of mutations and not only that they are changing. Another highlight that we try to include here that is not in other similar approaches out there is that we are leveraging this low frequency variants from the Galaxy pipeline. And as you can see here, the amount of low frequency variant is not negligible in these samples, in this data. And also there are interesting cases where you can find low frequency variants that are variants that are very prevalent in the population. And as all you know, this can be of importance for therapy or for maybe for virulence, etc. So as a highlight of this of the examples, also to simplify this probability of interhost variants, this is a typical use case when you would only, for example, could be curious about whether a different amino acid chaining variant have occurred in the same position as this very famous one. And for example, we have found that indeed, from the low frequency variant, we can see that a variant in that position was appearing back in April in a bunch of samples before it ever appeared in any consensus variant, that it only occurred in August. So this exemplify that interhost variants that are even not so low frequency can be of any of a predictive possibilities. Another use case for interhost variants would be to find out whether there are recurrent or common subconsensus variants that are never found in any consensus database like this yet. And for example, to simplify here, we have found that over 5% of frequency, of population frequency, there are at least this amount of recurrent variants that with a range of allele frequency in the samples and belonging to a range of proteins in the genome. For example, this is one example where it actually has appeared this variant that you can find using a query for receptor binding domain and a relatively high population frequency. It's a variant that is recurrent, but it's subconsensus. And it has been found in a big number of variants at low frequency, but it was only found so far two times in consensus variants. Consensus assemblies. This is not a case where user might be interested in knowing whether and this example, for example, that we have found whether this variant has a increase very fast in the population frequency from its first appearance in March, and where you can see that Illumina data would have a better predictive value in the sense that given that you're capturing low frequency variants, you can see.
Claudia, one more minute.
Yes. Sorry. Yes, that is increasing in it's easier to spot that it was increasing in March from low frequency variant than it was for consensus variants. And also it was that the data for low frequency allows to see that the allele frequency in the samples was also increasing in average. This is that we have implementing other tools, and this is the genomic browser that we are now developing. So the users can actually spot one variant and see the actual alignment of reads of sample or position. And well, yeah, this is all. We would love to know if you have any use case or any feature that you would like to see implemented in the beacon, so we can help better. in this goal orient.
And thank you.
Sorry, just take the longer time. Mm-hmm. I will be happy to answer questions.
Thanks, Claudia, for this presentation. I think you've developed a very potent tool for viral research. And maybe I've lost some of the information, but how frequent is to find the low frequency variants? In which percentage of samples can you identify them?
Yeah, well, we only have low frequency variants from those passing. We are not, I was too fast, I went too fast through it, but this is a pipeline that Galaxy actually is doing, not us. And they have rules for, of course, enough deep of coverage to call this low frequency variants. But anything that from that, so they are getting from most of the samples, low frequency variants. They are lower than the consensus, and the ones that are in consensus. So we, from most of them, we are having low frequency, like under 0.5, but very, very low to the number of very, very ultra deep sequencing sequences that we have.
Okay, thank you. If there are no more questions, maybe you can move to the next talk.
Thank you very much. Okay, next speaker will be Gemma Chavarria Miró. She will talk about the sentinel surveillance of SARS-CoV-2 in wastewater, anticipate the occurrence of COVID-19 cases. Gemma, whenever you want.
Okay, thank you very much for your introduction. Okay, so good morning, everyone. I'm going to present a review of our study that is a sentinel surveillance of SARS-CoV-2 in wastewater in the area of Barcelona. So we already know that SARS-CoV-2 is a respiratory virus that can be shed coughing and vomiting, but it's only been seen that it can be shed by feces, and also it seems that it can be shed in little amounts in urine. The excretion tool, it seems to be more prolonged than the one in coughing and vomiting. And consequently, the wastewater, and that can therefore reach the wastewater treatment plants. So this led us to study the occurrence of coronavirus in the wastewater. And this makes a perfect tool to support COVID-19 surveillance systems and therefore to enable a rapid adoption of mitigation measures. Yeah. So in our study, we weekly analyzed two wastewater treatment plants. The first one, it was Adar-Besòs, and the second one was Adar-Prat de Llobregat. Adar-Besòs is the biggest wastewater treatment plant in Spain, with a capacity of 525 million liters per day, whereas Adar-Prat has a capacity of 420 million liters per day, and both together represent around 85% of the densely populated metropolitan area of Barcelona, what enables us to perfectly study the occurrence of SARS-CoV-2 in the metropolitan area of Barcelona, and not only for symptomatic, for asymptomatic or undiagnosed carriers. So the methodology we used was that once we received the sample from the wastewater, we took 800 milliliters of the sample and we perform a precipitation with polyethylene glycol 6000 that suspended in 3 milliliters of PBS. Of these 3 milliliters of the concentrated sample, we took 1 milliliter to perform the extraction, the NucliSense Minimac extraction system by Biomerier, and we eluted in 50 microliters. So once we had the sample concentrated and the extraction of the RNA, we perform a one-step real-time qPCR assay that targeted four regions of the coronavirus genome, Here we have the picture of the coronavirus genome, and below the targets that we used, that were the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase gene that we target, two versions of this gene, IP2 and IP4. After that, we also did the E gene and the N gene, specifically the region N1. So here we have in this graphic depicted the results we obtained. We can see Adar Bazos and Adar Pratt. If we take a look in IP2 and regions, well, we have to have in mind that the lockdown of the population here in Spain, it was in March 15, and we can, for example, here in the graphic of Adar Bazos, that we started to weekly analyze the samples from April 13 until June 20. We can see that the early beginning of the lockdown, we had high levels of genome copies per liter in the week, and it started to decrease until May 18th, where the genome copies were below the limit of detection. So this clearly shows that the lockdown of the population worked here in Spain. And here you can see marked when the phase one was implemented in Spain, that after that, we could see that during June, the genome copies started to increase again. And in these arrows, we have depicted also when the phase two and phase three were implemented. In fact, phase three was delayed because we started to detect some high levels of genome copies, as we can see here for IP2 and IP4, and also the same tendency in Adar Bazos. So it was delayed because we communicated that, and they decided to delay phase three in Spain. Luckily, we also had some archival samples from other studies that we had in the laboratory. So we decided to analyze them. And we surprisingly found that the first presence of coronavirus genomes were January 15 in Barcelona, whereas the first confirmed COVID-19 case in Barcelona was February 25th. So what does this mean? This means are able to detect SARS coronavirus 2 occurrence 41 days before the declaration of the first COVID-19 case in Barcelona. So this gives us an idea that we may have been misclassifying some COVID-19 cases as influenza or other respiratory viruses, but also it shows that this tool to wastewater monitoring can anticipate and can show in advance the presence of SARS coronavirus circulation in Barcelona. So if we had knew that in advance, we would have been locked down before, and we would have stopped the spread of the virus before.
Gemma, I regret to tell you that you have 1 minute left.
Okay, yeah, it's, I'm just finishing. So we also analyzed for urban sewers in order specific hotspots of COVID-19, because we were analyzing specific areas. And if we take a look in sewer 3 and 4 that belong to the neighborhood here in Barcelona, they had high levels of genome copies for several targets that we analyzed. And in fact, these two sewers drained to the Edar Prat, that we can see that in May that they were no undetected genome copies. Then we started to see the genome copies, high genome copies levels during June and the end of June and early July. So we also detected in advance 3-4 weeks the outbreak of this neighborhood. And to end this talk, I would like to say that the waste-based epidemiology is a valuable early warning tool for tracking the circulation of the virus in the population. As I said, not only for symptomatic, also for asymptomatic and underdiagnosed cases. SARS coronavirus 2 occurrence in wastewater evidence the efficacy of the lockdown measures. As we have seen, we had a decrease of the genome levels. And to end, that Sentinel surveillance virus 2 in wastewater complement other COVID-19 surveillance systems, such as PCR tests, to adopt rapid mitigation measures and to stop the spread of the virus. So to end, I would like to thank all my colleagues, Edu, Adam, Marion, Cristina, and especially thanks Albert and Rosa for the, and I'm open to questions if you have some, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Gemma. Has been a very nice presentation. In fact, I think I will call you because I think for the animal viruses, we should implement many of these things that you are doing here. Probably some people is doing for sure, but not in our case. Mm-hmm. I have a question, a very silly question, probably due to my ignorance. Can you recover live virus or is always you always detect genome copies?
You mean coronavirus or other viruses? Because in coronavirus, yeah, we are detecting just, it is said that the virus is inactivated, so we only detect the genome copies.
But you didn't try, no? It's just to know if you can recover.
Yeah, but the coronavirus, it's a respiratory virus, so when it's shed, practically all inactivated, so it's not an active virus.
So that's not a concern for the health? Any
no,
of these?
No, not at all.
Perfect. Very, very, very interesting. Thank you very much. I think we pass.
Sorry, Fernando, we have like two questions from the audience.
Ah, fantastic. I didn't see them.
Bajo.
Bajo, please. Can you... Okay. I have one from Josep Kerr. Can you give us some information on which is the present situation?
Okay. Hello, Josep. Now we are analyzing not only wastewater in Barcelona, also in several wastewater treatment plants in Catalonia and also in Spain. And we are seeing that it's increasing a lot the genome copies in all Spain. So this situation is going worse and it should be stopped.
I have another question from Juan Jose López Moya. He hates me, and it's a very difficult question. I don't know if I will be able even to read it. This is, E and N genes are present in the genome and in subgenomic RNAs, but in virus particles, you expect only targets coming from the genome. Is this correct? Is the correlation of the positive is for the three targets reflecting that?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
I think I will ask my friend Juanjo to make the question because it's difficult for me even to understand this as written.
Yeah, because I didn't understand very well the question. Yeah.
I can jump and maybe yes, you can hear me.
Please, Juanjo, yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, okay. The question is that the two genes that you are analyzing can be also in subgenomics. So if you are detecting yes. targets that are fragments of RNA, you will expect to have more of the E and N than the others in the IP. But if you are only detecting the ones that are in particles, perhaps you will have always the same positives in the three. Is that this is the question.
Okay, so the problem that we have is that there's no a standard protocol for analyzing wastewater because it's an environmental sample. So it's difficult to find a standard protocol. And in our hands, IP2 and IP4 work better. So we first always analyze two and after that we confirm with the other ones. But it's difficult to say if one works better or the other one because we should in a standard protocol when we all the labs talk and have time to do it.
Okay, thank you very much. We have to move on. So I pass the word to my colleague.
Yes, let's move to the next talk. Thank you, Gemma. The next talk will be presented by Eva Forés, and the title of her talk is Does Size Matter? SARS-CoV-2 Surveillance in Different Sized Wastewater Treatment Plants. Whenever you want, Gemma.
Hi, Eva. Good morning. I'm going to start with my presentation titled Does Size Matter? SARS-CoV-2 Surveillance in Different Sized Wastewater Treatment Plants. So, wastewater has become a potential tool for SARS-CoV-2 surveillance in the frame of wastewater-based epidemiology. Through the analysis of population-pooled wastewater and comparing this data with the public health cases, including the shedding rate, the normalization of the population, and calculating the infected individuals per capita, we are able to create epidemiological models that could be helpful predicting the evolution of the pandemic. So the aim of the study is select and adopt a method for SARS-CoV-2 surveillance in wastewater and study the presence of SARS-CoV-2 in 10 different size wastewater treatment plants. This work has been done by our laboratory with the collaboration of ICRA. Well, waterborne viruses are responsible of gastroenteritis and hepatitis and are transmitted by the fecal-oral route. These viruses can contaminate the water sources and are diluted in the environment. So for its detection, it is necessary to do a concentration step. These viruses are generally non-enveloped viruses, but the SARS-CoV-2 is an enveloped viruses. So there's a lack of standardized protocols for its detection in the environment. Or there's a need on data on the recovery performance of viral concentration methods for enveloped viruses in water samples. So our laboratory have presently reviewed the main methods for viral concentration of the enveloped viruses, including SARS-CoV-2. The main methods are the centrifugal ultrafiltration, are methods based in adsorption processes such as flocculation or precipitation, are a combination of filtration and adsorption, and finally, with ultracentrifugation. The data we are showing below correspond to viral recoveries. The first one are calculated using qPCR results, and the second one are calculated through the infectivity assays. And I have to say that the viral recoveries are calculated using different surrogates. So considering that every single virus has a different behavior during the viral concentration and the data available are variable, our laboratory decide to validate two ultrafiltration-based methods. The methods are the Centricum Plus device, which is a centrifugal ultrafilter, and the pipette concentrator for InnovaPrep. The pipette is an automated equipment which uses ultrafiltration tips. Both methods have pros and cons. For the Centricum Plus, I would say it's a rapid method with a 30 kilodaltons of cutoff, but is only compatible with the swinging bucket centrifuge. And during the outbreak, the Centricon had product shortage. For that, we decided to validate the pipette. The pipette is also a rapid method. The ultrafiltration tips have 150 kilodaltons of cutoff, and the elution is done by using the InnovaPrep's patented wet foam elution. And all the equipment fits in a biosafety cabinet. The cons for the pipette, you need the equipment, of course, and the tips are single use too. So in order to compare both methods and validate the pipette, we decide to compare in parallel, to concentrate in parallel a selection of samples. First of all, we spike the samples with MS2 as a surrogate of non-enveloped viruses, and with murine hepatitis viruses, a surrogate of enveloped viruses. Well, prior to ultrafiltration, we perform a step of debris elimination through a centrifuge. The resulting sample, we discard the pellet, and the supernatant is divided into aliquots. One is filtered through the Centricon device, and the other through the pipette. The resulting concentrates are extracted and detected by qPCR. For SARS detection, we quantify the N1 and N2 genes, which codifies the nucleocapsid of the virus. Then we also quantify the human adenoviruses and JC polymerviruses as a human fecal indicators. And finally, we quantify the surrogates as a process controls. Well, in this slide, we are showing the recovery efficiencies obtained for the surrogates with the two methods. For MS2, surrogate widely used in recovery studies, the methods do not show statistical significant differences. But for murine hepatitis virus, a beta coronavirus proposed as a surrogate for SARS-CoV-2, the methods show statistical significant differences. But for the natural occurring viruses, no statistical significant differences were observed, including the SARS-CoV-2 for the N1 and N2 genes. Well, by applying the pipette during March to August of this year, a weekly sampling was done in 10 different sites wastewater treatment plants. Here, we are showing the correlations between SARS-CoV-2 wastewater presence and incidence per inhabitants of two of the 10 wastewater treatment plants, a large one and a medium one. The correlations between COVID-19 and SARS-CoV-2 in wastewater were observed for large wastewater treatment plants. Or in other words, the tendency that presents the COVID-19 fits with the concentrations quantified in the wastewater. However, for the medium wastewater treatment plants, these correlations were not always observed. If we evaluate the effect of the wastewater treatment plant size in SARS surveillance, we can generate the following box plots. Here, I'm only showing the box plots for N1. In the x-axis, we have the genome copies per liter, the concentration of the virus, and in the y-axis, we have the wastewater treatment plants per thousands of inhabitants. And the wastewater treatment plants are sorted by incidence. We can see the higher SARS-CoV-2 concentrations were observed in the bigger wastewater treatment plants or in the medium, but in the presenting high incidence. Sorry. And for the one small wastewater treatment plants, presenting high incidence too was under the limit of quantification of our technique. So these preliminary results are being further analyzed with larger databases, because if we generate the same box plots for the natural occurring viruses, this pattern was not seen for the indicators, which were present in similar concentrations in all wastewater treatment plants, independently of their size. The possible reasons for SARS-CoV-2 levels was under the limit of detection of our technique, maybe because the people who is infected with COVID, the excretion rate is low or with a heterogeneous distribution. Maybe because the RNA is easily degraded in wastewater, or maybe it could be due to a sampling effect in the wastewater treatment plants. So on this, does the SARS-CoV-2 detection in small wastewater treatment plants more challenging? And to conclude, these results suggest that the usefulness of wastewater surveillance for SARS-CoV-2 in the small wastewater plants should be further evaluated. The pipette concentrator used in this study has proved to be an automated, efficient, fast method, and two ultrafiltration-based methods has been compared and validated for wastewater surveillance, with no statistical significant differences were observed between methods. And that's all. Thank you for your attention. And if you have some questions.
Thank you, Eva, for your presentation. I don't know if there are any questions, but I was wondering which is the limit of detection? Is it determined by the amount of sample you can process?
We have the limit of quantification, which is the minimum genome copies we can quantify with exactly with accuracy. And then we have the limit of detection is the limit with what we can detect. If we are detecting below of that limit, we can not confirm that it's real the amount of we are.
My question, I was wondering whether if you increase the amount of water that you filtrate and concentrate, you can increase the limit of detection. So
in this case, for the analysis of environmental water and for wastewater, the volume processed is between our levels, we filter 100 milliliters. If it's a river water or sea water, we can filter 100 liters. That is a lot of volume. But in the wastewater, the viruses are really concentrated.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I think there are no more questions from the audience. So if that's the case, we can move on to the next two talks, which will be two flash talks. Thank you, Eva. The presenter is José Acosta Cáceres, and the title of José's talk is Insertion and Folding of SARS-CoV-2M Protein.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Good morning, everyone. I will talk about insertion and folding of M protein. Our goal is to determine the topology of M protein. First of all, we started with the delta G prediction for the topology determination of M protein. In this prediction, the algorithm suggested four hypothetical transmembrane. Triclear 1 and 4 less hydrophobic. To verify this prediction, we tested the M protein using the system PK top. The PK top is a genetic system with a dual reporter that allows us to determine the orientation of the transmembrane insert in the membrane. In this case, involving the M protein, we cloned different truncate to a study. Here. We cloned different truncate to study the topology in bacterial membranes. In the result, the first, third, and fourth truncate showed the C-terminal cytoplasmic orientation with red bacterial cells on the plate. Here, here, and here. With a second truncate, the observed orientation C-terminal periplasmic orientation with blue bacterial cells on the plate here. To verify the result, we started a similar experimental design using human eukaryotic cells. In this case, again, we saw the same result, but using a system-based in glycosylation site as a topological reporter. With this system, the first transmembrane showed a C-terminal orientation here, and the second transmembrane had a C-terminal out orientation. And finally, the third transmembrane showed again C-terminal cytoplasmic orientation in concordance with the PK top result. After determining the topology, We started with a computational modeling of M-protein domains. The molecular dynamic showed a good peaking with the three helixes of the M-protein, reinforcing the topology described before. In summary, the result from the experimental work using biological membranes from bacterial and human cell mixed up with the computational molecular model gives us a similar result which was in concordance with in silico prediction. That's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose. I don't know if there are any questions. I was wondering whether if you have any hint on the putative interactions that can be formed with the cytoplasmic motifs and cytoplasmic tail of the protein.
The interaction is the three domains, domain one, transmembrane, domains two, and domains three. Here we have the amino acid peaking with the interaction and on the three transmembrane.
And with cellular proteins, do you have any hint on which proteins can interact?
Can you repeat, please?
I was wondering whether the cytoplasmic motif, the cytoplasmic tail, can interact with any, if there is any idea on the cellular proteins that can interact there and transmit signals.
In this system, Picatoid system, we're using no evaluate interaction, but we using a system prokaryote membranes interaction, no evaluate.
Okay, thank you very much for your talk. Let's go back to Sandra Martinez Puchol talk. So Sandra will present her talk that is entitled SARS-CoV-2 Detection in Clinical Samples and Urban Sewage by Target Enrichment Sequencing.
Okay. Do you see the computer, the slide?
Yes, without any problem.
Thank you. So thank you for the introduction. So I will follow the talk that my colleague Eva Forest just did in wastewater-based epidemiology, but focusing in the use of next-generation sequencing technologies. NGS applications has arisen as promising tools for the genetic characterization of SARS-CoV-2 from clinical isolates, but also from sewage. Their use in sewage could be the key for an in-depth study of the excreted virome, not only focusing in SARS-CoV-2 circulation and typing, but also to detect other potentially pandemic viruses within the coronaviridae family. With this aim, two composite samples, sewage samples from March and July, were sequenced by applying viral NGS as well as applying a target enrichment NGS. We also compared the sequences obtained from sewage samples with ones sequenced from clinical isolates with the same technology, in the month of March. This is a brief outline of the methodology we followed. After viral concentration and nucleic acid extraction, libraries were prepared in parallel. One was directly sequenced, and the other was previously captured with a probe-based enrichment kit that favors the sequencing of vertebrate viral families. So here are the results. A full virome of the analyzed sewage sample was obtained, including members of the family coronaviridae. Sorry, the graph is not showing, okay. Members of the family coronaviridae only in the sample from March and when target enrichment was applied. Among them, one quantic was from human coronavirus OC43,
And then 8 contigs belonged to SARS-CoV-2, comprising around 2,000 base pairs. These SARS-CoV-2 contigs, these 8 contigs, were compared with those obtained from clinical specimens. And we observed 3 nucleotide differences in the nucleocapsid region, but we did not obtain enough read coverage in the C-weight sample to confirm if they are single nucleotide variants or if it could be due to a sequencing artifact. Apart from these human coronaviruses, we obtained 3 animal coronaviruses, applying only the enrichment protocol. So taking all this into account, we have seen that the application of a target NGS has provided with nearly the whole genome of SARS-CoV-2 in clinical samples and 8 contigs of SARS-CoV-2 in the wastewater sample from March. The use of this panel designed to cover vertebrate viruses allow us the obtention of SARS-CoV-2 sequences as a part of the sewage biome, but also it retrieves other relevant human and animal coronaviruses in the sample. So our take-home message is that the specific SARS-CoV-2 sequences and human coronaviruses, specific SARS-CoV-2 panels and human coronaviruses should be used for studying their genetic diversity, while panels targeting a wider variety of viral families could be a better choice for first evaluating the co-circulation of known and unknown human and animal coronaviruses with the potential impact in zoonosis. And also these panels could favor the study of other coronaviruses strains that are circulating in the population and their putative role in immune cross-protection. So if you have any question, I will be happy to answer. It's a bit quick, but thank you.
Thank you, Sandra. I was wondering whether this next-generation sequencing, this in-depth sequencing, improves the limit of detection in wastewater samples. So are you able to detect lower amounts of...
Yeah, when using these panels that are enriching specific viral families or viral types, you can widen the depth of sequencing you have in a sample, and you cannot waste reads in other viruses or on other bacteria that you are not interested in, and all the reads, all the output you generate from the sequencing will be focused in these specific viruses. So you can improve these detection methods in these complex matrices like sewage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think there are no other questions from the audience. I cannot see any of them. So
okay, thank you.
This, we end this session. I don't know, Nuria, I pass.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the speakers and the chairs for your excellent work. And